Thank you very much for your invitation. Hello to all participants of the Winter Challenge of 2022. My name is Dr. Nikolaos Kyriazis. I'm an adjunct lecturer in Money, Banking and Finance at the Department of Accounting and Finance and at the Department of Economics at the University of Thessaly in Greece. Today we're going to talk about the nexus between debt, inflation, and conventional monetary policy and cryptocurrencies through the lens of COVID-19 pandemic. Thereby, we're going to talk about four different subjects after the introduction: the debt, inflation in particular, and conventional monetary policies that have been followed since October 2008, that is since the outburst of the global financial crisis, and have been intensified since the early 2020, that is when the launch of the COVID-19 disease has taken place. And also we are going to expand to topics about modern financial assets, such as cryptocurrencies and central bank digital currencies. What is particularly interesting during this pandemic is the connection between all of these. This is because COVID-19 disease has serious influences on debt, on inflation, on conventional monetary policies, and on digital forms of investment such as cryptocurrencies and central bank digital currencies. We are going to examine and set a critical viewpoint about the nexus between these four alternative economic and financial aspects. Moreover, at the end, we're going to draw our conclusions and provide some avenues for future research. As I have started saying, the outbreak of COVID-19 in early 2020 has launched the dynamics for a new financial crisis, but has led to intense volatility in financial market. What is the particular characteristic of this crisis is that it has begun as a health crisis. It has rapidly transformed into a serious financial crisis, but could have been more serious than the 2008 global financial crisis if unconventional monetary policy measures hadn't taken place very rapidly. The COVID-19 disease has led to higher debt accumulation in a very rapid pace, to higher inflation, that is the increasing of price levels have been very fast, and more extensive unconventional monetary policy measures, especially in advanced economies such as the USA, Japan, the Eurozone, etc. And these have hurt the traditional capital and financial market, that is, during great crisis, investors do not prefer to invest in stocks or bonds, but prefer to invest in more risky assets in order to counterbalance the damage that they have suffered from conventional markets. Thereby, popularity of Bitcoin and other substitute cryptocurrencies has rapidly increased since the early 2020. Thereby, Bitcoin has rendered more popular even to risk-neutral investors. As we can see, the distribution of patients from the COVID-19, a great percentage of patients has been in the United States, that is approximately one-fifth from the total amount of patients. Moreover, we can see the accumulation of total cases of total patients as time evolves since the early 2020 until nowadays. We have seen rapidly increasing cases, which has been more rapidly increasing in an intense manner since the end of 2021, but it has been not so lethal. The target of this presentation is to make a thorough presentation of how the behavior of debt, inflation, monetary policy, and modern financial assets has changed due to the COVID-19 disease, and this has led to a health in combination to a financial crisis. The aims of this presentation is to enlighten as concerns the nexus between macroeconomic and financial measures. When we say macroeconomic, we mean debt and inflation, and financial as concerns monetary policy measures is unconventional monetary policies, and financial vehicles, financial assets, concern cryptocurrencies and central bank digital currencies. Thereby, a nice connection is going to be made between macroeconomic factor and financial factors. Moreover, the other purpose is to provide a roadmap for policymakers, for consumers, as well as investors, by highlighting the main economic implications of policies during these extraordinary occasions, that is, during the last 2 years since the outburst of COVID-19. We can see in these pictures the debt, how it has evolved for the US and for Japan since the outburst of the COVID-19. We can see here in 2020, in the beginning. And this is a more informative graph as it starts from 2008, the global financial crisis. The shaded area that we see here is the start of the global financial crisis, and this has triggered the necessity for bigger and bigger accumulation of global debt. The same, we can depict here the debt of the US, and we can see here the debt, how it involves when it comes to Japan. The global debt nowadays is about $300 trillion. It's a little lower than $300 trillion. This is very large in comparison to the $83 trillion dollars that took place at 2000, that is 22 years before. This is twice the rhythm of the GDP growth in a global level. As it comes to developing countries, COVID-19 has caused more damage to them because they are more vulnerable to fluctuations of financial indices, to volatility, again, fluctuations of interest rates and of currency values, in respect to other currencies, that is exchange rates, and the volatility of investor capital and of stock exchanges. That is, the median investor that is not highly sophisticated or highly experienced could not face the COVID-19 pandemic without losses in the risk return trade-off in their portfolios. As concerns the poorest countries, there has been large increase of debt. And these poorest countries try to avoid being into a memorandum, and they prefer taking loans from capital markets in order to avoid being in the status of a memorandum. It should be emphasized that about $35 trillion in debt should be paid during 2022. This is about half, 50% approximately higher compared to 2 years before, that is 2020. Thereby, we see a rapid pace of accumulation of debt. Debt, higher debt, necessity for higher debt has affected the US and Europe, that is advanced countries and other advanced economies. And it has also reached throughout the globe to Asia, to Africa, and has all of these countries globally in the international level have been pushed to accumulate more debt. But some poor countries, some developing countries, such as Sri Lanka, El Salvador, Ghana, and Tunisia, are considered to be even more fragile. Thereby, there is more necessity for investors and for consumers to have access to cheaper cost of borrowing. And this is the reason why in the Eurozone and in Japan, the last few years, negative interest rates have been imposed in order to provide more cheap liquidity to investors and consumers. This is one of the primary, this is one of the most important methodologies in order to drive down debt. Nevertheless, the total cost of interest is about $10.2 trillion in 2021, that is approximately 11% of the global GDP. Furthermore, there is necessity, as we have said, for cheap liquidity, and there is high pressure in order for rates to remain to be low and to remain low. There are a lot of countries that exhibit higher debt-to-income ratio, that is Lebanon, Nigeria, Greece, United Kingdom, China and the US, Argentina, Sweden, Switzerland, and Denmark between them, among them. Debt repayment proves to be very difficult because of the power crisis. There is expensive electricity, expensive, very high, elevated prices of oil, as well as for natural gas. And all these are in combination with high geopolitical risks, such as the incidents in Ukraine. Higher risk premia and to higher cost for every economy in the world. There are also rumors about tighter monetary policy, but this is going to happen in the near future in the form of higher interest rates. And the rumors say that it will start, will be launched on March 2022. So there is going to be lower inflation. This will lead to higher debt burden for borrowers. It will be very difficult for one that wants to borrow, either a consumer or an investor, to find cheap liquidity. Thereby, when lax monetary policies tend to stop and tighter monetary policies are about to start, debt accumulation is going to happen in more rapid pace. Let's go to inflation. When it comes to inflation, it is nothing more than the rhythm by which the level price increases. We can see inflation in the US and we can see inflation in Japan. We can see that it has a rapid rhythm of increasing. There are some pros and cons, some advantages and disadvantages of the level of inflation. The ECB is the European Central Bank's mandate, the target, in other words, is that GDP growth target is 4% and the rate of price growth, that means inflation target, should be about 2%. This is considered to be very good in order to achieve stability as regards price, but at the same time, an adequate level of GDP growth. Higher inflation has a lot of disadvantages and also has some advantages. Higher inflation leads to lower predictability of macroeconomic variables. Moreover, it leads to lower propensity for consumption. Apart from that, it leads to weaker motivation to invest and to lower GDP. Moreover, poor families are more hurt, and this means that there are larger socioeconomic inequalities. This also leads firms that enjoy less, that are hurt, are characterized by less elastic supply to be more hurt, to be more damaged as regards their profitability. The of higher inflation is that there is higher demand for higher wages, and these wages are disaccordingly to the productivity levels. Thereby, this is not convenient for the producers. Moreover, higher inflation leads to higher necessity for increasing interest rates in order to fight these high levels of inflation. And this leads to higher interest rates is translated into higher cost of borrowing. Moreover, there is high moral hazard and the risk of economy to getting accustomed to external help. Moreover, there is risk of stagflation, that is, despite increasing inflation, there is no spare, there is no boost in nominal GDP. And moreover, finally, there is the risk of loss of eligibility to further spare the economy. This is the reason why high levels of inflation are not preferable, because we are going to fall into the liquidity trap, and further inflation cannot lead to further increase in production. Moreover, despite that, nevertheless, there are some advantages of inflation. Inflation, when it is in small or modest levels, can provide some beneficial boost to economic activity. It is very important that the higher inflation is, the less is the debt burden for those who owe money. Less real debt for borrowers, and there is lower cost of borrowing. We have to emphasize that supply side inflation is faster and more harmful than demand driven inflation. Thereby, inflation that is caused due to high cost for producing products is more menacing, is more difficult to confront. Let's go to unconventional monetary policies. Unconventional monetary policies has been introduced by about 2005 and has been exercised in most advanced economies during 2008, that is, since the outburst of the global financial crisis after the Lehman Brothers collapse. It is interesting to take a look at the evolution of the total assets of the US Fed. we can see that during 2008, there is an immediate increase, a very large and abrupt increase in the total assets of the Federal Reserve. This has continued approximately about 2014, where QE tapering has started in the US. And we can also see that the larger US total assets have taken place in order to prevent a new global financial crisis when the outburst of the COVID-19 disease has taken place. Moreover, we can see that a lot, but really a lot of QE and conventional monetary policies has been presented has taken place by the Bank of Japan. According to the ECB, European Central Bank, price stability is the best contribution that monetary policy can make to economic growth. This is the main motto of the European Central Bank. Is this still valid? The target of the 2% inflation should be surpassed or should be maintained at all costs. Whatever it takes to save the euro was said by Mario Draghi, the central banker, at 26 of July 2012. The most immense threat recession than ever is nowadays due to the COVID-19. Our helicopter money draws the only option. There is risk of greater moral hazard. These are very important questions that have to be answered by economists. There are two sides. One side is that if we not contact unconventional monetary policies, that means monetary authorities do not take action and make QE announcements, then recession will be harsh. On the other hand, if the economy is accustomed to QE measures, then economy and financial markets will always demand for help. We'll always like to have helicopter money drops, that is to give a lot of money, a lot of liquidity with no cost, with no hope for repayment. Some key interest rates that the European Central Bank uses and generally monetary authorities use is the interest rate on the main refinancing operations. Banks can borrow funds from the ECB against collateral. Moreover, it is the rate on the deposit facility banks may use to make overnight deposits as the preset rate lower than the main refinancing operations. Moreover, it is the rate on the marginal lending facility that is offers overnight credit to banks at a preset interest rate above the main refinancing operations rate. These key interest rates are directed from the central monetary authorities in order to ease monetary conditions and to provide a boost, to provide a spur to the economy. Moreover, other conventional monetary policy tools is offering banks as many central bank loans as they need against collateral at a fixed interest rate, or setting negative interest rates as the European Central Bank has made or the Bank of Japan has made in order to encourage banks to lend at low rates so that people and businesses can borrow at low cost. Moreover, offering long-term loans to banks, including loans on the condition that banks lend this money to people and businesses. This is called the targeted long-term refinancing operations. Moreover, purchasing public and private financial assets, that is one of the main forms of contacting unconventional monetary policies. Monetary authorities come to asset purchases that are considered to be risky. Thereby, they continue into buying long-term bonds in order to provide liquidity to firms that are in need for liquidity. And this is very helpful in order to advance the economy. Moreover, they provide forward guidance that is making clear of the central bank's intentions for future monetary policies. We have to emphasize here that forward guidance is much more effective when it is conducted not a very long time before it happens, the monetary policy is conducted. Thereby, when unexpected moves by central banks take place, they are more effective than when all these are incorporated into the perceptions of consumers and investors. We continue. to talk about cryptocurrencies and central bank digital currencies. Cryptocurrencies constitute the most modern form of investment and of liquidity nowadays. Bitcoin has first appeared in 2009. It was created by Satoshi Nakamoto. It was not popular at all until 2012. It became very little popular since 2012, and it has increased, its popularity has rapidly increased during 2017, where the large boom, the skyrocketing increase in the cryptocurrencies market has taken place. Apart from Bitcoin, that is approximately higher than 50% of the total market capitalization of cryptocurrencies, other popular cryptocurrencies such as Ethereum, Litecoin, or Ripple have taken place, have been created since approximately the mid, since July of 2015. Now there are over 10,000 cryptocurrencies that are traded in global cryptocurrency exchanges. And this has attracted a very, very large number of investors which consist of risk-loving investors, that means speculators, as well as investors that are risk-averse or risk-indifferent. We can see here the evolution of Bitcoin. It has started at very, very low prices. It has reached approximately 60,000 American dollars, and now we are in a bear market. It has fallen, but many of investors expect that it should go up again. Can speculative and volatile assets such as Bitcoin and general cryptocurrencies that cannot be used as units of account be efficient stores of value during high inflation? The main problem that arises here is that these cryptocurrencies could be profitable for investors, thereby they could help investors in order to ameliorate, in order to improve their risk-return trade-off in portfolios. But on the other hand, they can only be used as mediums of exchange, but cannot be used as stores of value or as units of account. Thereby, should they be considered as hedges and safe havens during the crisis? Can they be similar to gold and other precious metals? This is a very important question. The majority of economists believe that no one can imitate the safe haven properties that gold or silver or palladium can exhibit. On the other hand, we can see that an increasing number of investors have been using cryptocurrencies in order to fortify their portfolios and in order to reduce the total risk suffered in their portfolios. High inflation suppresses the purchasing power and suppresses aggregate demand. This is because, let's say that someone takes a wage of $100 per month, and prices keep changing, the price level keeps increasing. Thereby, this consumer can buy less units of products than before. Investing in cryptocurrencies can bring higher returns than cash or stocks. This is a very important question, because if one is a successful manager of cryptocurrencies, he can enjoy very large levels of profitability. Thereby, he could invest, let's say, today $100,000, and at the end of this year, $1,000 could have become $500,000 or $1,000,000. Thereby, we are talking about skyrocketing profits. On the other hand, if he is not lucky enough, because the factor of luck is very inherent in the cryptocurrency markets, thereby, if he is not very lucky enough, or he is not capable enough of managing this portfolio, he could suffer great, but very great losses. On the other hand, we can say that inflation is unpredictable, but also the fluctuations of cryptocurrencies are unpredictable in a very high degree. So, cryptocurrencies could constitute a remedy for inflation, or are just speculative risk investments with a high probability for success or for high returns, but also a probability for great losses? We have to stick into our minds, all of us, that we are investors, but cryptocurrencies are highly volatile, are highly speculative, even more volatile than the inflation that is difficult to predict. when it comes to stable coins, that is a solution that could erase, that could confront some of the disadvantages of decentralized cryptocurrencies. Stable coins are one form of cryptocurrencies that are linked with traditional assets such as the US dollar, and could they be the solution to risk aversion that pushes investors away from cryptocurrencies? And how are stable coins affected during crisis? My opinion is that stable coins could erase some of the disadvantages of, that is, the instability, the large fluctuations that cryptocurrencies exhibit, and at the same time provide an adequate level of profitability. Thereby, stable coins are considered by a lot of economists to have a perspective to replace an awful lot of a great number of cryptocurrencies. So, in as there is the new digital era we are coming in, stable coins are considered as one of the favorites to be very popular among investors. Why many central banks are favorable towards central bank digital currencies? Are they more reliable than cryptocurrencies, and why? Of course, we could say with high levels of certainty that central bank digital currencies are more safe than the decentralized cryptocurrencies. The reason for this is that they are issued by central monetary authorities, that is, by the central bank of each country or of each region. Thereby, there is going to be money supply in the form of central bank digital currencies, will provide a very nice solution to the liquidity drainages that a lot of investors and consumers face nowadays due to the COVID-19 pandemic. But a lot of disadvantages of the cryptocurrencies will be confronted. Thereby, there will not be such high volatility, so large and unpredictable fluctuation, but there is going to be a considerable level, a considerable perspective in order to acquire profitability and to improve the risk-return trade-off of investors' portfolios. There is the guarantee, there is going to be the legal tender provided by the central bank, and this takes a quantum leap forward, these forms of investments and liquidity. Central bank digital currencies are going to be more preferable than the decentralized cryptocurrencies. We are going to talk about the nexus between all these economic and financial measures that we have talked about, that is about debt, inflation, and conventional monetary policies in the form of QE and cryptocurrencies during the COVID-19 pandemic. There is a positive connection between all of them. That is, the COVID-19 pandemic has led to higher levels of debt accumulation, has led to higher inflation by a very rapid pace, to a higher necessity for exercising extremely expansionary monetary policies, as we have seen from the evolution of total assets in the central bank balance sheets, and also in very higher levels of popularity of digital liquidity and modern financial assets in the form of cryptocurrencies, and with the perspective of creating central bank digital currencies, that is a large tendency nowadays by advanced countries, that is from the United Kingdom, as well as less advanced countries such as Latin American countries. All of them are very keen on developing their own central bank digital currency in order to reap the benefits of the innovators of the first countries that have adopted central bank digital currencies. All these are all higher debt accumulation, higher inflation, higher QE, expansionary policies, and higher levels of investing in cryptocurrencies are favorable during the growth phase of a business cycle, that is when we are in normal conditions and we are trying to reach the growth, great growth in the economic cycle, in the business cycle of the economy, but their excessive use can lead to inefficiency of these policies. Thereby, we should not reach the highest levels of debt accumulation, the highest level of inflation, the highest levels of unconventional monetary policies, or the very large extension of cryptocurrencies to render them inactive. When they are adopted in very high levels, then they render inactive. Can high digital debts alleviate the creation of high money debts? This could be the $1 million question. This is the most important question that financial economists have to answer nowadays. There had been, as we have said before, very, very large accumulation of debt in an international, in a global level. And it is very difficult to sustain these unbelievable high levels of debt, especially by emerging countries. Thereby, there is some thought that all these developing countries should adopt digital currencies, should invest in cryptocurrencies, or to be more realistic, should invest in central bank digital currencies. Thereby, this could lead to higher accumulation, to very high accumulation of digital debt. All the debts of these indebted countries could be, from now on, not the old debts, from now on, could take the form of digital debts, could take the form of debts in digital currencies. We should emphasize that digital currencies, digital debts, as we can see later, a digital debt can be much more rapidly accumulated. Thereby, we can confront high money debts by constructing high digital debts. Are these digital debts repayable? This is a very important question that has to be answered. Digital debts will be accumulated very fast, more fast than the accumulation of money debts, but it is a very serious question whether these digital debts could ever be repaid. The worst scenario could mean that high digital debts could be formed, high money debts could be formed, and thereby developing economies, but also advanced economies, could have entered and not leave a death spiral that will lead always to new necessity for memorandums. And thereby, the global debt should increase and increase and increase and never stop. Will decentralization of the money system result in smaller or greater problems? As we have said, digital debt can be much more rapidly accumulating. Cryptocurrencies and central bank digital currencies could lower the demand-driven inflation in the short run, but what happens in the long run? It is very nice to reap the benefits of higher and cheaper liquidity through accumulating digital debt in the short run, but what happens when this excessive liquidity bursts in the long run? In order to conclude, we have to ask ourselves whether the unconventional monetary policies conducted by major advanced central banks such as the European Central Bank that has conducted the pandemic emergency purchase system has been useful. Could economies be worse without the inflationary boost during COVID-19? That is, we keep complaining that there is a lot of inflation, there is a lot of debt accumulation, there is a high level of being accustomed to unconventional monetary policies, and this creates major problems of moral hazard. We are going to be used to this, and all economies are going to keep asking from their monetary authorities to provide more and more liquidity as time passes. But would there be a possibility that things would have turned out worse if there was not this inflationary boost, if there was not this debt accumulation, if there was not this intense lax monetary policy, it would be very worse. It is much more difficult to take an economy out when it has been deep into a recession than preventing the economy from falling into a recession. We have to admit that in comparison to the global financial crisis of 2008, the reflexes, the reactions of central banks in a worldwide level have been much faster. Moreover, can cryptocurrencies decrease accumulation of money debt? We have already commented on this. Can central bank digital currencies decrease the necessity for QE? Of course, QE is a mean in order to provide cheap liquidity to investors and consumers. Central bank digital currencies should be balances that each of us, each consumer or each investor of us will have directly with a central bank without need for intermediation by commercial banks. This can reduce the cost of transactions and moreover provide a more credible financing alternative, as it is much more reliable for a person to or for an enterprise, a firm, to borrow money from the monetary authorities than to borrow money from a commercial bank. Can cryptocurrencies counterbalance the income and wealth losses due to the growth generating inflation that has been caused by the peril of recession? Of course, we have to stress out that there have been large levels of income and wealth losses due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and the economic classes and social classes that have been more damaged are the lower income and wealth classes. Thereby, can cryptocurrencies lead to better distribution of wealth on the medium run or in the long run? We have to point out here that the creation of cryptocurrencies has as the motto that it should be that they provide a coin, a currency for poor people. Thereby, the next economic revolution, as it by supporters of cryptocurrencies, is going to be based on poorer countries or developing countries. Until now, this has not made its appearance. This effect has not been true. But we hope that by being more financially sophisticated, literate in developing countries, this will lead to a better redistribution of income in favor of the poorest wealth classes. And the end has the combination of higher debt, higher inflation, more intense and conventional monetary policies, and larger cryptocurrency investment proven useful for fighting the COVID-19 consequences. In order to say for all of this, we could argue that all of this have been helpful. It would have been very difficult if there was not higher debt accumulation, if there was not higher inflation to boost demand, if there were not lax and conventional monetary policy measures in order to prevent the economies to fall into the recession, and if there was not cryptocurrency investment that could help ameliorate the profits in our portfolio and provide cheap liquidity in order to continue investing. Thereby, all of this debt, inflation, unconventional monetary policy, and digital forms of money have been helpful in order to fight COVID-19, but we should emphasize at all costs that this should not be kept for a long time, because they would risk of rendering inactive. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. We've got a couple of questions in the chat, so I can read them out.
I can see them. You're very welcome to add your code. Okay. Will cryptocurrencies break down the dollar hegemony and take the main place in the future? Of course, this is a scenario that could take place in the future. And why so? Because accumulating debt in the US dollar has been very large. It is believed by a very large number of economists that cryptocurrencies can take the hegemony as concerns transactions. But this could not be, according in my opinion, this shouldn't be in the near future, maybe in 5 or 10 years from now, when people in advanced economies and in developing economies should be more accustomed, should be more literate in handling the devices, in handling the digital money, then the cryptocurrencies could take the dollar hegemony. But to be more realistic, not cryptocurrencies just like Bitcoin, Ethereum, Litecoin, or Ripple, central bank digital currencies are going to take over the financial system in about a decade from now. This is my prediction. I would be glad to clarify, why are cryptocurrencies so volatile while their circulation is considered to be predictable? Of course, what we can do additionally to technical analysis in such cases? Cryptocurrencies constitute a special case, a special occasion, But it is really, but really very difficult to conduct technical analysis in order to predict all this. Cryptocurrencies are very volatile because they are completely decentralized. They are decentralized and they are prone, they are very vulnerable to speculators. So you cannot predict speculators. Let's say that example, this has taken place a lot of times in the cryptocurrency market. There is a cryptocurrency that for 2 or 3 months, it has been constantly falling. It has been decreasing. And suddenly there is a 100% raise within a night. Who can predict this? Technical analysis cannot predict this. This is because cryptocurrencies are very much volatile and they are not able to confront the speculation motivation, the speculation actions that render them unpredictable. This is the reason why risk-loving investors should invest in cryptocurrencies in order to gain awfully lot of profits, but they should also be ready in order to suffer awfully lot of losses. This is why central bank digital currencies is a most realistic, is a more realistic option to take the hegemony of the financial system in relation to decentralized cryptocurrencies. What policies can help countries reduce debt vulnerabilities that were caused by COVID? Memorandum would be a very nice solution, but all countries, the great majority of countries, are very reluctant to face memorandum measures. On the other hand, they could, what is meant to be now, there could be some raise of interest, some increase in interest rate, thereby to make a taper to stop unconventional monetary policies, extra lax monetary policies. These vulnerabilities could be confronted in a depth of time, not right now, in about one decade or some decades from now. And there should be, all countries should try to achieve some stable, such as the ECB mandate, as we have seen, and a level of inflation of about 2%, and a growth rate of about 4%. This is to, they should try to achieve stability and the GDP growth at the same time. Okay, something else?
Okay, thank you for your questions and for answers, and thanks for your time. So we will send the recording to the broadcast, and thank you for spending your time with us. We wish you luck at your rounds of the Winter Challenge that you are about to face. Hope this lecture will be super helpful in that. Thank you again, and goodbye. Thank you.
Goodbye.